Here it is, that time of year again where we're thinking out with the old and in with the new. We become a little introspective and we think back on the year just past us, or we look forward to the year ahead of us with excitement and maybe some big plans. And along with those plans, sometimes will come a New Year's resolution. Now, it could be where you're looking at, how can I be a better spouse, or how can I be a better friend, a better employee, or how can I live a healthier life? And sometimes that causes people to evaluate their relationship with alcohol. Now, I'm not saying you have to be an alcoholic to consider your relationship with alcohol, even so-called moderate drinkers of this drug. Sometimes take a look at how it's impacting their life and what it's doing to them rather than what it's doing for them. And as we make these New Year's resolutions, or as we look at the relationship with alcohol, it's easy to question, how do I get to this point? And if you've gotten to this point where you're thinking it, you might want to take some action. It takes a constellation of things to evaluate your relationship with alcohol. Sometimes it's a nudge from the judge. Perhaps you got arrested for drinking and driving, or maybe it was a domestic dispute. Maybe it was a disorderly conduct. Any range of things where you wouldn't have done it if you weren't drinking, that should be a hint that that nudge from the judge might be your opportunity to evaluate your relationship with alcohol. It does take a constellation of things to get a person to look at their drinking and consider quitting. For example, it could be the employer saying, your work isn't quite up to what it used to be. Take that as a message. And if a spouse or a loved one says to you, I'm worried about your drinking, you have to take those words very seriously, because it takes a tremendous amount of courage for somebody to bring that up face to face and have that kind of discussion with anybody. So please take that very seriously. It could also be your health, because this is a drug that your body doesn't tolerate very well. Ordinarily healthy human tissues do not react well to drinking a toxin and known carcinogen in any amount. So how do you take the next step, or what is the next step? Well, the next step medically is very simple to do, just stop drinking. However, we live in a culture that worships drinking. We see it on television, every game we watch, almost every program on TV. We hear about it on the radio. It's part of our culture, and it's going to be hard to separate yourself from that part of culture. But do look at the friends, the people, the places, and the things in your life. Also look at just switching up your routine a little bit. If you're ordinarily taking a certain track home, certain pathway that drives you right past the liquor store, you might want to skip and take a different route. Another thing is to do at a gathering, start drinking water. Water is very good for you, for one thing, and it takes your mind off of not participating in the imbibing, even though you're drinking something that's vastly more healthy. Dry January is another very popular thing, whether it's Dry January, Sober for October, Alcohol Awareness Month in April, Dry July. All of these things are a great time to put aside the beer or the wine or the mixed drink just for a month, just to see how good you feel in that 30 days. And just take it one day at a time. You may not prescribe to the 12-step point of view, but that's one thing they get very right, and that it is a one day at a time kind of thing. You don't have to plan ahead to say, oh my God, February 1st is so far away, I don't know what I'm going to do with myself. Just look at January 1, January 2, January 3, and so on. When you wake up in the morning, that is the wake-up call that you should be answering. Most important of all is start now. Why wait? Start today. Don't put it off till tomorrow, because sometimes tomorrow doesn't come. And that's not an ominous threat or anything. It just means that there's no better time than the present to take the first step toward being a healthier and happier you. Can you change your relationship with alcohol? Yeah, you can. It's not easy. Nobody says it is, and nobody can do it for you. And if you're on the other side of the equation, you wish somebody was going to stop drinking, or you wish they would stop immediately, you can't do the work for them. Whether you're an alcoholic, the loved one of an alcoholic in training, or a non-alcoholic, we all drink for the same reason, and that is to relieve stress. I talk about stressors in Every Silver Lining Has a Cloud. This is my second book that was out during the series. I'll be introducing you a few more of those. But one of the things that I talk about in that book is look at the stressors in your life, how you react to them. If you bury them, if you put them off, you might be doing yourself more harm than good. Your body produces a stress hormone, cortisol, And the more you bury things, the more you put off the stress and do nothing about it, the more the cortisol builds up. And what's a great relief for cortisol? Alcohol. Now, it could seem uneasy or unnatural to put off the alcohol when you're out for dinner or out with clients, out with family, or just relaxing after a long day at work. But give it a day or two. Fight through this. If you cross your arms in front of you fold your arms in front of you unfold them and put the arm that's on the bottom on the top. That feels unnatural. It feels uncomfortable, but it didn't kill you. So fight through it. Make it become natural not to drink rather than to reach for the next one. What causes problems is one, and they only get worse. They don't get better with alcohol. In fact, can you think of a problem that won't get worse by drinking it under? I'm Scott Stevens. We're going to have episode 2 coming up for you.